The latest generation of Wi-Fi is here. It's actually been around for a little bit recently, which is Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E by extension. Now, the technical term is actually 802.11ax, but I guess they figured the number system works a little bit better, so the previous one, 802.11ac, is therefore Wi-Fi 5, but the latest one is 6. Now, the other one, Wi-Fi 6E, you might not have heard of. It's still part of Wi-Fi 6, but has one important additional feature, which is actually huge. So what I'll do is first explain what that big difference is, and then also how Wi-Fi 6 and 6E are both way better than Wi-Fi AC or Wi-Fi 5, the previous one. And of course, I'll try to break down the really technical stuff and explain it as simply as possible so you don't have to be some kind of expert. Before we jump in though, I want to thank today's sponsor, Blinkist. I'm sure many of you, like me, probably wish you read more, but don't always have the time to do so. That's exactly where Blinkist comes in. This app has taken thousands of the top nonfiction books and has created much shorter text and audio explainers of them called Blinks. In around 15 minutes each, you can learn the key takeaways from these thousands of titles in 27 different categories, from science to psychology, investing, personal development, and more. For example, I think you've heard of the famous and famously long book, Wealth of Nations. This absolute unit of a book has been sitting on my shelf unread for years, but now, in just 9 minutes, I was able to listen to the key points. And if you crank up the speed a bit, you can actually get it done even faster if you want. And they have a whole bunch of really well-known stuff. For example, one top seller I was familiar with was Stephen Hawking's A Brief History of Time. So if you want to check out Blinkist, the first 100 people that go to blinkist.com/TheoJoe will get 1 week of free unlimited access so you can try it out. The trial is completely free and you can cancel it at any time, and you'll get 25% off if you do end up wanting to get a full membership. So again, link's right here, and you can also click on the same link down in the description. And now, let's continue. So what is the deal with Wi-Fi 6 and 6E? Well, for context, I do want to point out they both do have the same features and improvements over Wi-Fi 5. I'll go over what all those are afterwards, and they include all of these things, but it's important to know that 6 and 6E do have basically the same functionality. However, the difference comes in the frequency spectrums. So while Wi-Fi 6 supports the same 2.4 and 5 gigahertz bands as previous Wi-Fi 5, Wi-Fi 6E will actually support an additional third 6 gigahertz band that was just recently opened up by the FCC and registered for unlicensed use, meaning Wi-Fi can use it. And other countries are also opening up part of the 6 gigahertz band, all for use in Wi-Fi. And this might not sound like a big deal. Oh, we already have dual bands. Why do we need 3 bands? But it actually is a huge deal, and I'll explain why. Practically speaking, though, what does this mean? How is it any better? Well, the biggest benefit is going to be in spectrally noisy areas. And what I mean by that is areas that have a lot of Wi-Fi signals bouncing around, a lot of access points and routers. For example, offices, apartment buildings, public venues, stuff where a lot of people are going to be on their phones and all connecting to similar Wi-Fi hotspots. With this new spectrum, it's going to allow a whole bunch more space for Wi-Fi channels, so different access points don't have to be competing over it, and it's going to have way less interference. You see, when you set up a router, you have to choose or have it auto-choose a single channel it's going to operate on, and then all your devices are going to be connecting on that single channel. And a channel is basically a certain range of the full 2.4 or 5 or 6 gigahertz range. You only choose a small part of it. The fewer the channels, then the more those are going to have to be shared by nearby access points, such as your neighbors. If you have more than 3 neighbors, like an apartment complex nearby, then there is going to be some overlap and you're going to have to both be potentially using the same channel. It's going to cause a lot of interference. And the current 2.4 gigahertz especially, but also 5 gigahertz range, both have some shortcomings that 6 gigahertz will solve. Consider 2.4 gigahertz, for example, the most common one, ironically. Did you know that there are literally only 3 non-overlapping channels on 2.4 gigahertz, and it's used by a whole bunch of other stuff, not just Wi-Fi. It's used by Bluetooth, baby monitors, car alarm sensors and stuff, even garage door openers, microwaves when you run them, and not to mention a whole bunch of different smart home protocols like Zigbee and stuff. I mean, it's a mess. Now, the 5 gigahertz spectrum should theoretically have fixed this. I mean, it's got the entire 5 gigahertz to work with, so that's way more than this basically 100 megahertz of 2.4. So why is 6 gigahertz so much better, even though 5 gigahertz is basically the same amount of frequency and we have that now? Well, in reality, the actual really usable amount of the 5 gigahertz spectrum is not as big as you might think. Now, it is significantly bigger than 2.4 gigahertz. For example, where 2.4 only has 3 non-overlapping 20 megahertz wide channels, 5 GHz has 25 channels. Except, not really. You see, 16 of those 25 5 GHz channels are what are called DFS channels, dynamic frequency selection. These are channels that happen to share the same frequency used by radar from airports, weather radar, stuff like that. And there's actually a law in the United States and elsewhere that basically says because radar was used before and they don't want Wi-Fi interfering with it, even though Wi-Fi can technically use these channels, all Wi-Fi devices and routers have to have technology built in to be able to detect radar signals. And if it does, it has to shut off the Wi-Fi, which means if you live near an airport or near a weather radar station that's sweeping by all the time, then those DFS channels are probably going to be completely useless to you. And also, because of these restrictions, a lot of consumer-grade routers don't even allow you to select these channels, because if people didn't know about this and they started using those channels and then their Wi-Fi kept randomly cutting out, then they would probably blame the router for having crappy connectivity when it's just following the law. So they don't even let you connect to those. So really, you have a very limited number of those 5 GHz channels that don't have this restriction in there. So really, you only end up with 9 truly free Wi-Fi channels, which is still better than 2.4. But with 5 GHz with AC Wi-Fi, there's actually a technology that a lot of routers use or are able to use where it combines different multiple channels. So you can have 40 MHz channels made of two 20 MHz channels, or even 80 or 160 MHz wide channels, combining a whole bunch. And usually, an AC router is going to try and by default do about 40 megahertz wide. And considering the DFS channels, that means there are only about 4 40 megahertz wide usable channels if you're gonna do that. It's not required, but it will get you the higher speeds. If you are in a very, very crowded environment, then you will probably have to only use 20 megahertz wide, even on 5 gigahertz. And then if you wanted to use 80 megahertz wide channel, there's only 2 of those. And with the 160 hertz, then both of them are either completely engulfed or partially engulfed by those DFS channels. So you might not even want to use those. But again, 5 gigahertz is still way better than 2.4 in pretty much every way except range. It's faster, there's more channels, but since those non-DFS channels, which are limited, are pretty much the standard ones, then it might not cut it going forward to be future-proof. That's where 6 gigahertz comes in. And the 6 gigahertz full spectrum is actually from 5.925 to 7.125 gigahertz. That's actually 1,200 megahertz, a little bit more than a full gigahertz. And that means it supports a whopping 59 20 megahertz channels. And then those can be divided into 29 40 megahertz, 14 80 megahertz, or 7 160 megahertz. However, there are some caveats. For example, in the United States, the FCC did regulate which parts of that full spectrum can be used outside with standard or higher power Wi-Fi access points, and which can be used in lower power indoor use. Now, the good news is that for indoor use, consumer uses, you can use any of the channels. All of them are allowed. It's just that on outside routers, which might be used on venues and stuff, then those are restricted and only 41 out of the 59 are usable there. But still, you don't have to worry about that restriction unless you're running a business or something like that. And it's still a whole bunch. 41 is still a lot. The other major caveat, which is the most unfortunate, is that if you're outside the United States and Canada and some other countries, most of Europe, for example, is not adopting yet the full 6 gigahertz spectrum. They have only adopted an unlicensed use of 5925 to 6425 megahertz range, which is half of what the United States and Canada have done. That means that those of you who are in Europe or elsewhere on this map where it's labeled are only gonna have 24 new 20 megahertz channels supported worldwide. Now, I'm really hoping, and it does seem like this is the case for now, that Wi-Fi chip manufacturers are just going to, by default, add in the capability for all of these chips to support the full 6E, 6 gigahertz spectrum and not just limit it because it's limited halfway in Europe, but they should definitely at least add the capability to have the full thing and maybe enable it by software later in case Europe does end up adopting the full 6 gigahertz spectrum, which there has been some pressure to do that, though they haven't really talked about it yet. But anyway, the basic huge benefit of 6 gigahertz is that you're gonna have way more space and able to not only have more channels if you need less interference, but you can also have way bigger channels that are gonna have a lot more bandwidth, especially if you're not in such a crowded area. But what's also cool is with this many channels, say you're at an outdoor concert venue where there's thousands of people all on their phone, and you as the venue setup person, you could set up 40 different Wi-Fi access points basically right next to each other, and each of them could have their very own individual channel. So even though they all connect to the same network, as people use their devices to connect to the same Wi-Fi network, it'll show up as one, as a mesh network, but their phone will automatically connect to one with the least interference. It'll be able to balance across 40 different things and just have way less interference for all those people, if that makes sense. Now, there are only a handful of Wi-Fi 6E devices so far. I believe for in terms of routers, Asus, Linksys, and Netgear have a few. And as for devices, I believe the Galaxy S21 Ultra has it, and I believe the upcoming iPhone is supposed to be rumored to have it. So it's coming along, just, you know, it's gonna take a little while, and you will have to upgrade your router to be able to use that, by the way. Now, I did say I'd go over some of the big ways that Wi-Fi 6 and 6E are both way better than Wi-Fi 5, more than just having this extra new frequency. First of all, it's a lot faster, potentially. So you can have up to 3.5 gigahertz per Wi-Fi stream, spatial stream they're called, and you can have four of these up to, depending on how high-end the device is. And therefore, theoretically, one Wi-Fi router could have a throughput of like 14 gigabits per second, which is kind of insane. The other big technological feature of Wi-Fi 6 is something called OFDMA. This basically allows the router to split one channel into many subunits and broadcast to several devices at once. For like every broadcast pulse, I guess you could say, for every time unit, it can then do multiple devices, whereas right now, they only send data on the whole channel to one device. Now, technically, if the router supports something called MU-MIMO, which is multi-user, multi-input, multi-output, then it can technically talk to multiple devices simultaneously, but this OFDMA will be another way and be combined with that, so it'll just be way more efficient and connect to a whole bunch of different stuff at once. And then there are several more technical improvements, all designed to increase the efficiency of Wi-Fi 6 in particularly high-density environments. That was really the main goal when they were creating Wi-Fi 6, is to just be used when there's a lot of density, because we're kind of experiencing that right now. And just Wi-Fi devices becoming more ubiquitous. Internet of Things, a lot more devices are gonna be crowding our waves. We need more space. If you do want a much more full explanation of all the little technical details and improvements Wi-Fi 6 does have, I did make a video about that a couple of years ago, so I went into detail there. You can click on it, I'll pop it out. So yeah, all that stuff though is for both 6 and 6E. It's just with 6E. You get that extra bandwidth. And I think that pretty much covers it. So thanks again to Blinkist for sponsoring this video. Again, you can go to blinkist.com/TheoJoe. You get a free week trial if you're one of the first 100, and I'll put the link in the description. If you guys want to keep watching, I'll put a link to that video where I explained way more in detail the different advantages of Wi-Fi 6. You can click on that right there. If you guys enjoyed the video, definitely give it a thumbs up and subscribe and hit the bell. I make 2 new videos a week usually, and you don't want to miss out on those. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next one.